But I'm delighted to welcome all of you. Thank you so much for being here. This is our annual Joint Visiting Committee Symposium. The theme of this year's symposium is focused on the goals for our new strategic plan. And we have named it Transform the Field of Cancer Care Through Discovery and Innovation. And I was talking to somebody in the audience, you, and he said to me, that's a pretty aggressive goal, what you've got there. And I said, yeah, it is an aggressive goal, but we're Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, and we have met aggressive goals before. We have always been on the forefront of cutting-edge research at Dana-Farber, from the discovery of cancer genomics to identifying the key protein that controls immunotherapy to epigenetics, another topic that you'll hear more about. So I am confident that we can fulfill these ambitious goals, in part because we're very lucky to have all of you. All the people in this room are helping us. You have remarkable foresight and remarkable generosity, and that's what's enabled us to push the pace of scientific progress and to deliver exceptional cancer care for the last decades. So I just want to make it clear that you, as our visiting committee members, are essential to this institution's success. And it's really a privilege for me to preside over this symposium for a third year. I'm really looking forward to hearing your ideas and your thoughts as we discuss how Dana-Farber can accelerate these new breakthroughs, which I know we can do, but we need it, we need help, and thence broaden our impact, because while we have done some remarkable things already in the treatment of cancer over the last decade or so, we are still at the tip of the iceberg. We're at the end of the beginning. We have a lot more to do. And before we get into that, I want to just give you a summary of the schedule for today. You can look at the agenda in your binders for more details, but I'll start by highlighting some of the advances we've made over the past year. I'll talk about Dana-Farber's new strategic plan and the comprehensive capital campaign. We're in the second year of the quiet phase of our capital campaign. And then some of our executive leaders are going to join me to add their perspectives and context surrounding the strategic plan, our priorities, what's been our progress so far, and what's needed to accelerate success. And we'll have some time at the end of that panel for your questions. After that, you move to your individual committee meetings, and then at 12:30, we reconvene here for lunch, at which time we're going to have a discussion with the CEOs of Bristol-Myers Squibb and Alnylam Pharmaceuticals, and that's going to be focused on patient-centered drug development. Directly following lunch, I'll be meeting with all of the visiting committee co-chairs for our executive session, where I'll hear feedback and ideas from today's meetings. And I very much value that. I very much value your feedback and looked through very carefully the feedback from last year's symposium. And I think that's part of our partnership to get your ongoing feedback as we continue to press forward together to achieve our mission. And our mission clearly is to continue to deliver exceptional care to our patients and make it even more exceptional, and to break down the barriers that prevent us from making all cancers manageable diseases, and some of them curative diseases. Several themes arose last year from the visiting committees. Some members recommended that we consider how to communicate to donors the critical role of drug development, and hence this panel today, this at lunch. So we'll talk about that. Other common themes were the need to invest in next generation, in the next generation of top cancer scientists, That is one of our top priorities. We have already recruited a wonderful basic scientist from Memorial Sloan Kettering to head our Department of Radiology. His name is Dr. Moritz Kircher, and he is a basic scientist who studies Raman spectroscopy and molecular imaging, something which is increasingly going to be important as we monitor how our patients respond to therapy and allow us to predict ahead of time using sophisticated molecular imaging who's going to respond and why. So we're very thrilled to have recruited Dr. Kircher from Memorial. Many members also said that philanthropy plays a vital role in propelling innovative research. I couldn't agree with that more wholeheartedly. And I will be spending a good deal of my time over the next few years raising the kinds of philanthropy that Dana-Farber can use so well. We need it, but even more, if I have a dream, I want 3 to 5 years from now to be able to see a patient come in for the first time, collect massive amounts of data about that person's cancer. Well, that would include clinical symptoms, molecular imaging, pathology, whole next generation genomics of the tumor, and complete sequencing of the immune cells, the immunoprofile, and to tie all of that information to the medical record so that someday when somebody comes into Dana-Farber, we can look at that patient, analyze all those data quickly, and be able to say to that individual, we know the right combination of drugs to put you on because we have all this information about you and because we've collected huge amounts of data of thousands of patients who have the same profile you do, and we know from history what they respond to and what they don't. Now, that's a dream, but I do think we can get there with your help. Other comments, every committee in some way discussed Dana-Farber's exceptional ability to collaborate. And I think this theme is going to permeate all aspects of our program today. We are an immensely collaborative institution, which is one reason that we've been able to move ahead so quickly, translating basic discoveries in the laboratory into new therapies for patients, because we all talk to each other, from the basic scientist to the clinician at the bedside. Collaboration across multiple disciplines is really the heart of our success. We also have very valuable relationships and partnerships with other institutions and with industry to accelerate progress. So this kind of feedback from you as insiders has really been important to me as we've spent the past year charting our future course for the Institute. I think you'll hear echoes of your observations and the resulting outcomes in the Institute's milestones over the past year and the new strategic plan, which I'm going to outline next briefly. It is no exaggeration to say that we are at a turning point in the field of cancer. This is an absolutely revolutionary time for cancer treatment and care. There have been two major revolutions, one in cancer genomics and one in immunotherapy. Dana-Farber has been at the cutting edge of both of those revolutions. Indeed, one of our faculty members, Gordon Freeman, identified the key protein that sits on the surface of the key immune cell in the immune system and that is now the target of the immunotherapy drugs that are out in the market and that have achieved such success. But still, only 20% of our patients respond to immunotherapy, and only some tumors respond to immunotherapy. So again, we're at the end of the beginning. We have a long ways to go. As our supporters, you have helped to propel the Institute for our 18th consecutive year as New England's top-ranked hospital. according to U.S. News and World Report. This is the 18th year that we have been the number one hospital in New England. And again, Dana-Farber is the only cancer center in the country that ranks in the very top rank in both pediatric and adult oncology, and you're going to hear more about both of those, pediatric oncology from Dr. Lisa Diller and Dr. Scott Armstrong, who is the chair of pediatric oncology, and we're very proud of that. I'm just going to share a few of the milestones that we've achieved over the last 12 months. A Dana-Farber study that was led by Dr. Brian Wolpin, who's chair of our gastrointestinal oncology group, and who focuses on pancreatic cancer, a cancer that has proven to be intransigent to all therapies that we have tried. He's made a step forward by doing real-time DNA sequencing in advanced pancreatic cancer, and has shown that that information can guide precision medicine and can improve patient outcomes. This is really a breakthrough. Another highlight, a team of Dana-Farber physician scientists led by Dr. David Barbie discovered that there's a class of retroviruses, which are viruses that are already built into your DNA and whose function has never been apparent. He showed that these retroviruses that are present in all of our human cells could provide a potential new target and a radically new approach to immunotherapy. Finally, Dana-Farber researchers led by Dr. Irene Gobrial, who focuses on multiple myeloma and also on Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia, is studying early cancer detection, because both of those diseases can announce themselves early in a pre-malignant state. And she's found that just by taking blood samples, you can monitor the stage of myeloma or Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia as a reliable alternative to bone marrow biopsies. And who wouldn't rather have a blood sample drawn than have a bone marrow biopsy? Now, here's a patient that really exemplifies the kind of care and innovative treatments that we can today offer our patients. This is Rob Dumphy. He's a 36-year-old attorney living with his wife and children in the Boston area, and just a couple months after the birth of his second daughter, his annual physical revealed a lump on the side of his neck. He hadn't shown any symptoms of illness, so this obviously came as a shock to Rob. His general practitioner referred him to Dana-Farber. After several weeks of what Rob himself describes as an uncertain, blurred, emotional whirlwind of appointments and tests, in July last year, he was diagnosed with stage 4 head and neck squamous cell carcinoma, which would, years ago, have been a death sentence. He underwent 2 surgeries and then radiation therapy, which Rob says is so counterintuitive to how we live our lives that it was difficult to stay positive at times. But he credits his amazing support group, both inside and outside of Dana-Farber, and he said, "It's easy to stay optimistic when you know that you have the best of the best providing your treatment." Rob Dumphy is only one of countless others. These are the people who are benefiting from your mission-driven work. Each and every advancement that we have is fueled by all of you in some way. And the Institute, we simply couldn't function without the consistent resources generated by the Development Office. And so now we're looking forward to launching a new era so we can transform the field of cancer care through discovering innovation. That's the goal of our strategic plan for the next 5 to 7 years, and it is an ambitious goal. It's built around 3 major components, all 3 of which are integral to our long-standing mission. which is to transform the cancer of science, that's pillar number one, expand the breadth of exceptional care, and expedite our progress through continuing to recruit immense talent. Because bricks and buildings are only the hardware, the software are the people that occupy them. Although we do need the infrastructure as well. So each of these broad components includes initiatives within it where we think that our research will have the biggest impact on accelerating cancer treatments, and where expansion and collaboration will enable Dana-Farber to bring our high-quality care to more people locally, nationally, and globally. And I'm pleased to report that progress is already being made toward initiatives of our strategic plan. For example, we have made some strategic decisions to expand our reach and breadth of care. That's underway. In 2020, we're going to open new satellites in the Merrimack Valley, in Foxborough, and an extension of our Longwood campus in Chestnut Hill. The Yawkey building will be filled to the top by 2020 because we continue to see amazing growth increase in the number of patients we treat. 6 to 8% a year increase in the number of patient visits. Other cancer centers in Massachusetts seem to be flat. We seem to be getting all the growth, which is wonderful. We can treat more patients, but we have to have room for them. And so we are building a facility in Chestnut Hill, which is going to be gorgeous. I visited it. It's at the site of the old atrium. And those of you who live in Newton or Brookline, I lived in Newton for 30 years. Remember the atrium? It was a shopping mall. Well, now it is home to Life Cycle. No, that's not the name of it. Lifetime, thank you, Deb. And it will be home to us as well, where we're going to occupy two very large floors. We're very excited about that. And we're excited about it not only because we can see more patients, and it's more convenient for those of our patients who live in Newton, Brookline, Wellesley, and so on, but it also enables us to do some creative things with Yawkey. And one of those initiatives, which is now on board, this opened in September, is an acute care clinic. So it's for our patients who are suffering serious side effects from chemotherapy, for instance, nausea, they may be dehydrated, who previously would have had to go to the emergency room, sit there for hours, get rehydrated, and most of the time get admitted when they actually didn't need to be admitted. And so we said, that's not acceptable for a number of reasons, primarily because it's not good for our patients. And so we're going to set up an acute care facility at Dana-Farber where patients can come instead. Outpatients, where we'll rehydrate, anti-nausea medications, and hopefully send patients home rather than to the Brigham. If a patient does need to be admitted, then we don't send them to the ER. We get a bed for them, and they go directly to the bed. So that's just one example that Craig Bunnell, our chief medical officer, and Ann Gross, our chief nursing officer, have come up with, and it is now online. And I think that's a good example of what we're already doing to meet the goals of this new and ambitious strategic plan. And we're going to talk more about additional initiatives in the plenary panel. But this is we've got a lot of great things coming along. Clearly, to complement this strategic plan, we need a very comprehensive fundraising effort to fuel our progress. So 1 year ago, we began the quiet phase of our new comprehensive capital campaign. This will be a multi-year effort stretching over probably 7 years altogether. We launched this a year ago, the quiet phase of the capital campaign. We have a trustee campaign planning committee that's chaired by two of our trustees, Monica Chandra and Bob Stansky. They're going to help us determine the key elements of the effort, including refining our case for support and our goals. We did terrifically well this year, thanks to Sue Bereski and her department. We have already raised $280 million, more than we've ever raised before at Dana-Farber. It's been given to the campaign. And that includes early support from 100% of our senior faculty and executive leaders, totaling almost $1 million. That's a truly remarkable statement of support when every 100% of people say, we love this place, we know we can do this, and we're going to contribute. We've had some very generous leadership gifts from our trustees, including $25 million from Richard Smith to provide capital funding for the Longwood Center, because we want to expand our space for research. $10 million from Richard and Nancy Lubin to support faculty recruitment, and an anonymous $5 million gift to accelerate ovarian cancer research, which will be under the leadership of Dr. Ursula Matulonis, who's here today. So I think we're off to a pretty amazing start. But you, as trusted advisors and mission-driven partners, your backing is essential. And I am very, very sincerely grateful for your steadfast commitment as donors and ambassadors for the institution. So I thank you from the bottom of my heart.